And so passing through these multiple jurisdictions means it's very, very difficult to create legislation in order to protect them or to reduce catch. And so we enter the world of the RFNO. Now, I don't know how many people in this room know. That's the first year of working at the Shark Trust was pure working out what all the different initials stand for. There are so many in our world. RFMO is the Regional Fishery Management Organisations. There are different RFMOs managing different patches of sea. These are the three, really, that the Shark Trust have been focused on with partners over the last couple of years. So you've got the North American Fisheries Organisation, which kind of manage that Northwest Atlantic. Piece up there and over there, it's been about raising the profile of Skari Skate in Greenland and also pushing fins naturally attached. We've got the GFCM, the General Fisheries Council of the Mediterranean. Obviously, the Mediterranean is an area of sea where you really wouldn't want to be a shark. It's kind of the worst place to live if you're a shark. However, the GFCM is very active and has high ambitions in terms of the conservation of the sharks within that zone. And then you've got ICAT, the International Commission for the Conservation of Atlantic Tuna, is that correct? Yeah. Which manages sort of most of the Atlantic. These are multinational bodies, multinational decision-making groups. ICAT, for example, has 52 different nations represented. So you can imagine how complex the decision-making processes are in order to move towards conservation of a species. So a couple of years ago, an organisation called the Shark League, a partnership called the Shark League, was set up. Shark Advocates International from the States, ourselves, Project Aware, Ecology Action Centre representing Canada, came together really to look specifically at these RFMOs and how we could introduce catch limits, aligning with scientific advice, put strong protections in for endangered species, and put strong and enforceable bans on shark fillings. So there's these kind of three prongs of action that the Shark League is active in. In 2016, the focus for Shark League was on blue shark, which is caught in very large numbers in the Atlantic. But in 2017, the focus turned on to the very urgent needs of the mako shark. So I want to tell you a little bit about the kind of what went into that and what came out of it and what we're doing next. So this is, I don't expect you to read all of this, just it's a pretty picture. But this kind of summarises the position going into the ICAT meeting, which was last November, I think. And that was that after years of being concerned about Mako in the Atlantic, had some stock assessment work done, and the scientific advice came back very strongly that the population was in severe decline. All of the models, and they all kind of align here. This is a COVID plot. I don't know what it means. Some of my out here might do, but I don't. But it basically, these are all clustered together, which means they all agree there is a 54% chance of stock recovery by 2040 if they just stop fishing makos altogether. So that's a 50-50 chance in 25 years of recovery if you stop altogether. So that's pretty stark scientific advice going into ICAT. And we felt very, very strongly that we should be advocating for a prohibition. The outcome was not that. The outcome was not a prohibition. The outcome was that live sharks had to be released. There's a requirement now to release live sharks that come alongside. And there's also a requirement to develop a rebuilding plan for fishermen and scientists to develop a rebuilding plan over the coming year to 18 months. So, disappointment that the prohibition didn't come out because of this very strong scientific advice. However, we've got something. We've got, you know, something happened. Something moved. So there's more work to be done. So coming straight out of that meeting, the Shark League partners put together these cards, which really kind of set out for the different nations that are involved in shark fishing, or the major nations that are involved in mako fishing, what the challenges are for each of those countries and what they need to be really, really focusing on. And so today, I'm just going to, later, I'm going to talk a little bit about Move for Mako, which is essentially the next step in our work, particularly in Europe, on Mako Sharp and kind of moving this process along and trying to push towards making sure that live catch ban is enforced, and B, seeing if we can still move towards prohibition. And Move for Makos is a public campaign. It's something that everyone in this room can get involved with. And so later I'm going to tell you what you can do. But before we go into that, I thought, because they've given me 50 minutes, I might relax a little bit and talk about some other stuff. So I hope you're all sitting comfortably. Before we go into it, I want to kind of just explore the bigger picture a bit. I want to, you know, one of the things that's really struck me in my 3 years at the Shark Trust is it's so complicated. Shark conservation is so complicated. Why is it so difficult to put conservation measures in place for these fantastic, charismatic, valuable, vital animals? Why is it so difficult? Why are we still, after really 25 years or so of being an active shark conservation movement, why are we still talking about conservation, extinction crises? Why are we still talking about that? When are we going to win this battle? You know, when are we going to win this war that we're engaged in? And I believe part of the problem is the battle analogy. I believe part of the problem is that we keep framing this as a battle. And so we keep, and battle implies there's an enemy, right? And a battle means you're fighting someone. And who is that enemy? We need to understand who the enemy is and why are we engaging with the enemy as enemies? And this is where I think we as a sector, as shark conservation, I'm kind of making a sweeping assumption that at least some of you in this room are in our sector, and the rest of you are obviously very engaged because you've sat here until 4 o'clock listening to people talking about sharks. So I'm going to address some potentially uncomfortable truths about shark conservation. Don't worry, not really going to, you know, cause existential crisis, I don't think. But I think we need to kind of think about some of these questions. And the first truth that I'm going to throw at you is truth number one. Shark fisheries exist. Deal with it. We've got to deal with shark fisheries. We can't hope that people are going to stop fishing sharks. They're not. It's always going to happen. So we need to work out how we deal with shark fisheries. Fishermen are not necessarily the enemy. I think sometimes that we pitch them as the enemy. And that isn't the case. Unmanaged, unsustainable fisheries, they're the enemy, but the two don't necessarily go in hand in hand. There are good fishermen, and there are bad fishermen, no doubt, but we cannot just always look at fishers as one group and pitch them as the enemy. They can be part of the solution. They are a valuable part of the solution. Bring back data. They can enforce the measures that we put in. They can help to move towards better solutions. So, analysis a couple of years ago said that only 13%, that's about one in nine, global fisheries are managed effectively. So there's a huge amount of work still to be done. And I believe if we're going to do that, we need to engage the fishing industry much more strongly than we already do. I think if we want to succeed in shark conservation, we need to be very careful when we talk about banning shark fishery. We need to be very careful about, and sometimes we do it accidentally, making enemies of the fishing industry and casting ourselves back into this battle mode. No matter what we do, there's going to be incidental catch and bycatch. No matter what we do, it will always happen. If we push for all or nothing, if we try and ban shark fishing altogether, it's going to become difficult, things are going to get covered up, we're just as likely to get nothing as everything. And when bans are adopted, that means then that incidental catch might get swept under the carpet rather than brought out into the open, and so that we can see the data and see what's being caught and manage effectively. So that's my, many people in this room are already on that bandwagon, you know, that we need to work effectively with the fishing industry, but I feel it's very important to address that. And the second thing that's very much linked with that is we need to talk about sustainability. We need to talk about sustainability in terms of, are we comfortable with the idea of sustainably managed fisheries? Are we comfortable with the idea of someone going into a shop and buying shark products which have got an MSC label on it? Is that desirable? Is that possible? Is it the future? We need, as a sector, we need to kind of understand that. What's the end game? What is the end game? And what does the future look like? Please don't take a photo of this and put it on Twitter. It's lighthearted. Is this realistic for the future? Might you end up having a bowl of shark fin soup with a Marine Stewardship Council attached to it? I don't know. I mean, how comfortable does that make people feel? I think it probably arouses kind of some feelings of discomfort. But where are we going with this? And I think we need to kind of talk about that and be very open and honest about it. So linked to that, I just want to put this up, and again, don't read this, I've just put it there, I don't know why really. The co-chairs of the IUCN Shark Specialist Group, Colin Sinfordorf and Nick Dolvey, have done lots of very good, very in-depth reviews on shark conservation and the future, and they particularly are advocating for sustainability. And they set out these five steps to sustainability. And the first step is obviously protect species with the lowest biological production. So there are species that will never be sustainably fished, and they must be protected strongly. We must make sure that they're not exploited and driven to extinction. There are some species that are just unsuitable. But for those that are, we need to implement precautionary management through the RFMOs largely, because a lot of this fishing is going on in the high seas. We need to use those international treaties like CITES and CMS to advocate and to support sustainable fisheries and trade. We need to develop nations, need support in transitioning towards sustainability from the developing country. Sorry, from the developed world needs to provide support to developing nations. And responsible, traceable shark fisheries should support informed consumer choices. So we should get to a point where if people want to buy shark products, they know where it's from, they know they have traceability, they know where it's from. That's their five steps to sustainability. And that's something we have to kind of understand and grapple with and decide for ourselves if we're comfortable with that. And then, and another thing linked to sustainability that I always kind of struggle with a little bit is that sustainable fishing and animal welfare don't necessarily always go hand in hand.